I know sexual purity is one of the elephant topics in the room. Isn't it so? Yeah, it is one of the very elephant topics in our history, our churches nowadays. But we thank God because He has continually given us His word that has been an instruction and also a guidance to all of us. Today we are going to speak on pursuing purity. And our guest guide specifically on sexual purity. And we thank God for that. When our BS coordinator was leading us to read the verse above there, I was like, that passage of me is enough for us to go. When you read from verse 1 to until verse 8, it is an enough instruction for those who love God and for those who are genuinely born again to read that verse and go home. Yes, but we thank God for He gives opportunities. The leadership, Musu, I am grateful. Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to minister on this topic. And as I was preparing my sermon, I found four things that were outstanding. And that is from verse 1 to chapter 4, from verse 1 to 8. And four things were outstanding for me. And that is what we are going to speak on in our today's sermon. That is the pleasure, purity, penalty, and possibility. Those are the four things you are going to look. It's not a rule that all of them come like four P's. It's not a rule. It's just that they're the things I saw they were outstanding from that verse. And when I was doing the sermon preparation, and to be true to us, friends, the statistics are really frightening. When you look at the age of 18 to 24, there is 70% of that age that indulges in sexual immorality. That is a very huge percentage. And also when you go to the age 20s and 30s, there is 66% of it. And that is a painful truth. To learn that in this era, there's a lot of sexual immorality. That is why when I was starting, I said it's an elephant topic. But friends, there is hope. Because I know all of us, we are in that category of 18 to 24, right? So that is the age you fall in. There is 70%. So there is that 30% remnant, which are purely pursuing God when it comes to sexual purity. That should be a joy for us, right? Mm-hmm. But then there is this notion of us Christians believing that when she's doing it. I know a friend in church does this. I'll also do it. But sure for you, you might be the only one in this hall indulging in sexual immorality. Not everyone does that. And for those who genuinely love God and pursue Christ, they pursue purity. And we are going to... I partitioned it into four. So we are going to start with chapter 4. Verse 1 and 2. And in chapter 4, verse 1 and 2, Paul instructs the church in Thessalonica this way. As for other matters, brothers and sisters, we instructed you how to live in order to please God. As in fact you are living, now we ask you and urge you in the Lord Jesus to do this more and more. For you know what instruction we gave you by the authority of the Lord Jesus. Pleasing God, I term it as pleasure. General living to please God. And you see, Paul was writing to the church in Thessalonica. He really had a huge affection for that church. It was vibrant and it was amazing. If you have read the book of the Thessalonians, all of it, you will see that when in the chapter 1, 2, 3 and 4, it basically talks of our service to God and how we live for God. And inside it, living for God includes the issues to do with sexual immorality, but for us living for God, we are going to see it as sexual purity, for us to live for God. And they had quite a number of problems, but in this one, Paul was asking them. He was asking them if they were really living for God. And actually, he was instructing them to live for God. And I want to narrow this down to us. I want to narrow this down to us today, this morning. Are you living for God? Is your character living for God? Is your speech living for God? That is the question I'm posing to all of us today. As Paul was posing that question to the church of Thessalonica, I want to pose to my church today. Is our life living for God? Are our thoughts living for God? If not, look into it. We are grateful because there's the aspect of purity. And in verse 3 to 5a, it is God's will that you should be sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality, that each of you should learn to control your own body in a way that is holy and honorable. Not in passionate lust like the pagans who do not know God. Just like what was happening in the Thessalonica, it's what is currently happening in our churches today. It's very painful, and it's the truth. Because we see senses all over. I hope you bear me witness. It's in the screens you watch, be it in our smartphones, be it in the TV, in the magazine, senses all over. And also in the adverts you see, like, the adverts to do with cooking oil. How many of us have seen the cooking oil advert? I hope it's all of us. And you see how sensual that the advertisement is. When you go to the soap, this soap that we may come in here from here. I know sexual purity is one of the elephant topics in the room. Isn't it so? Yeah, it is one of the very elephant topics in our churches nowadays. But we thank God because He has continually given us His word that has been an instruction and also a guidance to all of us. Today we are going to speak on pursuing purity. And our guest guide specifically on sexual purity. And we thank God for that. When our BS coordinator was leading us to read the verse above there, I was like, that passage of me is enough for us to go. When you read from verse 1 to until verse 8, it is an enough instruction for those who love God and for those who are genuinely born again to read that verse and go home. Yes, but we thank God for He gives opportunity. The leadership, Musu, I am grateful. Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to minister on this topic. And as I was preparing my sermon, I found four things that were outstanding. And that is from verse 1 to chapter 4, from verse 1 to 8. And four things were outstanding for me. And that is what we are going to speak on in our today's sermon. That is the pleasure, purity, penalty, and possibility. Those are the four things you are going to look. It's not a rule that all of them come like 4B. It's not a rule. It's just that they're the things I saw they were outstanding from that verse. And when I was doing the sermon preparation, and to be true to us, friends, the statistics are really frightening. When you look at the age of 18 to 24, there is 70% of that age that indulges in sexual immorality. That is a very huge percentage. And also when you go to the age 20s and 30s, there is like 66% of it. And that is a painful truth. To learn that in this era, there's a lot of sexual immorality. That is why when I was starting, I said it's an elephant topic. But friends, there is hope. Because I know all of us, we are in that category of 18 to 24, right? So that is the age you fall in. There is 70%. So there is that 30% remnant, which are purely pursuing God when it comes to sexual purity. That should be a joy for us, right? Mm-hmm. But then there is this notion of us Christians believing that when she's doing it. I know a friend in church does this. I'll also do it. But sure for you, you might be the only one in this hall indulging in sexual immorality. Not everyone does that. And for those who genuinely love God and pursue Christ, they pursue purity. And we are going to, I partitioned it into four. So we are going to start with chapter 4. Verse 1 and 2. And in chapter 4, verse 1 and 2, Paul instructs the church in Thessalonica this way. As for other matters, brothers and sisters, we instructed you how to live in order to please God. As in fact you are living, now we ask you and urge you in the Lord Jesus to do this more and more. For you know what instruction we gave you by the authority of the Lord Jesus. Pleasing God, I term it as pleasure. It's the general living to please God. And you see, Paul was writing to the church in Thessalonica. He really had a huge affection for that church. It was vibrant and it was amazing. If you have read the book of the Thessalonians, all of it, you will see that when in the chapter 1, 2, 3, and 4, it basically talks of our service to God and how we live for God. And inside it, living for God includes the issue to do with sexual immorality, but for us living for God, we are going to see it as sexual purity, for us to live for God. And they had quite a number of problems, but in this one, Paul was asking them, if they were really living for God, and he was instructing them to live for God. And I want to narrow this down to last. I want to narrow this down to last today, this morning. Are you living for God? Is your character living for God? Is your speech living for God? That is the question I'm posing to all of us today. And Paul was posing that question to the church of Thessalonica. I want to pose to my church today. Is our mind living for God? Are our thoughts living for God? If not, look into it. We are grateful because there's the aspect of purity. And in verse 3 to 5a, it is God's will that you should be sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality, that each of you should learn to control your own body in a way that is holy and honorable. Not in passionate lust like the pagans who do not know God. Just like what was happening in the Thessalonia, it's what is currently happening in our churches today. It's very painful, and it's the truth. Because we see senses all over. I hope you bear me witness. It's in the screens you watch, be it in our smartphones, be it in the TV, in the magazine, sex is all over. And also in the adverts you see, like the adverts to do with cooking oil. How many of us have seen the cooking oil advert? I hope it's all of us. And you see how sensual that the advertisement is. When you go to the soap, this soap is the type of a person you will be, I'll go have fun in my sexual impurity. No matter what. Are you this type of a person who is going to indulge in that art without even having the slightest concern of God in your heart? Then Paul says to you today, do you know your body is the temple of God? I know we don't usually think of that, but it has taken us too far. There are a lot of bugs we might be having. At the end of the day, I want to be saying, at the end of the day, and my partner. And when you think of the consequences, you are like, but I use a preconceptive. When I conceive, I'll go abroad. I'll go inject myself because no one is seeing. But you won't go all the way. It's just a kiss. It's just a hug. But you love each other. And he's meant for me and I'm meant for him. But waiting for sex in marriage for him. My dear friend, don't let all those paths carry you away. And I want maybe to be real with us and give us some action plans that I've been working for myself and my friends. It's for you as a believer to make a decision to wait for sex. Realizing that we got hormones, we got feelings, the all those dirty things we come across. But you as a believer shouldn't trust yourself. You don't have to trust yourself going to that room with a brother you know you dearly love. Don't go with him to that room. Because you know you're going to mess up yourselves. This is someone you love. Choose friends who have the same values as you, who are going to support you in whatever thing. Don't fill your mind with sex from music, movies, places and books. Stay away from alcohol and drugs. Speak to someone you trust. When you're in a relationship, look for accountability partners. These are the people who are going to help you walk your pathway in guidance with the scriptures. Push through loneliness, temptation, and tough times by remembering that God is with you and He says that you are beautiful, special and one of a kind. I hope everyone knows this today, that you are beautiful. It's not that I'm trying to pester you, but you are beautiful. You are made in God's image and likeness. Because there's this tendency of many people indulging in the same because they want to promote their self-esteem. My brother, my sister, I want you to trust God's word that you are beautiful and you are one of a kind. And above all, spend time with God and His word. His word is a dictionary. His word is got instruction. His word got advices that all of us can engage in. There is possibility. Having said all those, there is possibility. And you're here this morning and you're longing for sexual purity, there is encouragement for you. We see in the book of Romans chapter 7, the whole bit of chapter 7, it reminds us of our ongoing sin. verse chapter 8, it reminds us of our ongoing victory in the Holy Spirit. And this is therefore our motivator to our sanctification as believers. This is the possibility we are getting in the affirmation. When Jesus Christ died on the cross for our sin, for our rebellion, the blessings we receive is the blessings of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit, the same Spirit, makes sexual purity possible. Yes, of course, we have to apply strategies, like taking up responsibility. But at the end of the day, it is the Spirit that enables us to achieve and say no to all ungodliness. And this should be our reminder, as you earlier said, our sexual life, it's not our private life. God is involved in it. And this tells us that we should allow God in our lives. And how can we make this possible? The possibility of us living a sexually pure life. It is by saturating ourselves with knowledge. It is by saturating ourselves with the Word of God. And thanks be to God. This time round we are going to do a guide on pursuing purity. And when you get inside the guide, pursuing purity, you will see everything in it. And this takes us to this verse. How can a young man keep his ways pure? By living according to thy word. And friends, I want to encourage us to have this guide. Enoch kindly help me. In the BA study, we are going to do this book. Having known that this is one of the elephants in our churches today, inside this guide, there are amazing topics. The BS guide was developed as a follow-up to the Shahidi Forum held on 26 September 2015. A chastity campaign was launched as a follow-up at the National Leadership Summit, NLS, which is currently known as NLMS, 8 January 2016. The Bible study guide is aimed at equipping students with biblical knowledge and convictions for sexual purity. The study concludes with a signing of purity pledge cards. That is in the study 9. Every CU member is expected to go through the study guide and take the part in the chastity campaign. This is a part of perspective whereby the introductions are expanded and then they provide contextual issues. This is the let's talk. But if you attend those studies, they are going to be very useful and helpful to you. You are going to talk and share, and those will make memorable moments in your life. They are going to make you pursue the journey of sexual purity. Because there you are going to meet friends, you are going to talk to them, and form them as accountability partners. This is the digging in. The digging in comes the aspect of the scriptures. Like everything we ought to read there, it should be in the scriptures. And that is the tempo. Practical applications for individual members. At the end of the day, what do you take home? At the end of the day, are you going to apply what you've read, or you just leave them? It was just a BS. Yeah, in the topic, we're going to learn of the amazing nine studies, the part of appreciating the content. Then one is God's gift of sex and sexuality. There is perverted sexuality, reality of sexual temptation, consequences of sexual sin, and impurity. Dealing with sexual sin in the body of Christ, pathway to healing and restoration, the call to sexual purity, the purity pledge, and beyond the pledge. Friends, if I were you, I would have taken this opportunity. I wouldn't want to go under judgment for something I can have control over it by the help of the Holy Spirit. One, I'll buy this guy. Number two, I'll commit to be in the Bible study sessions for myself to be here. And as we conclude, we have looked at every sad reality of sexual immorality that has really ravaged our age. And at every corner, sexual immorality is lacking, desiring to master us. Even brands have realized it and are appealing to man's lust to close deals. But also, we have determined that God is not silent. What is God's voice in light of all this depravity? Through his word in 1 Thessalonians 4 verse 1 to 8, we've explored the four P's that God brings to our attention. That is his pleasure in matters of sexuality, his desire for sexual purity, his penalty for sexual sin, and the possibility of remaining sexually pure, despite all odds. I would like to invite us today to honestly seek God to help us live a sexually pure life. And you are the one living a sexual pure life. May the Lord grant you the strength only of living the sexual purity until the day You will say, yes, I do. As you conclude, I want us to arise.